So now that we've waded through the shallow inland sea of Confederate apologetics, I'm hoping we can all agree it's not the facts that are in dispute here so much as it is their implications. The debate isn't whether or not the Civil War was fought over slavery, that's a simple matter of fact, but rather how and why certain people choose to spin the history to suit their political objectives. Because make no mistake, Confederate apologetics is a political position, not a historical one. One which seeks to contextualize and defend the premeditated evils of long-dead white people before even attempting to understand and improve the social, economic, and political standing of living people of color. Some Confederate apologists will try and argue that you can do both at the same time, but in my experience, the people who spend their days making excuses for the Confederacy are not the same kind of people who'd support any kind of legislation that would prioritize the advancement and well-being of black people. On the contrary, they're the kinds of people who insist that they don't see color, even though study after study proves that we do, who retweet Candace Owens as proof that they pay attention to black discourse, and who misuse Martin Luther King Jr. quotes to try and silence the reparations debate before it even begins. Because remember, kids, if you're not in favor of reparations, then you're not really in favor of equality. Not in this century, anyway.
Are there any Confederate apologists still watching, or did y'all log off after I called you cowards?
Alright, as fun as it's been to dismantle racist propaganda for the last 25 minutes, I think I've proven my point, or at least thoroughly articulated my views. And that was important to me, because I feel I can't praise Gone with the Wind unless my audience knows my opinion of the real live Confederacy first. Real dead Confederacy? Now that you know what I think of Confederate lost cause mythology, I'm hoping you can follow along in good faith when I say that I think Gone with the Wind is an unmitigated masterpiece. A transcendent specimen of cinema that demonstrates the very apogee to which the filmic medium can ascend. Heh. Or at the very least, a damn fine film. I mean, the quality of the movie is the whole reason we're even having this debate, right?
It's not like we're about to have the same debate about Scarlet now, are we?
So for the most part, Gone with the Wind fans break down into two distinct groups. There are those who think the film is racist, but still well worth tolerating, because...
Well, the people who made it were racist. That's just the way things were back then. The real racism would be to not make it racist. It's just a movie. Why don't you quit your delusional social Marxist utopian virtue signaling for 2 seconds and just accept reality, you whiny feminist SJW cuck.
Which is all just a bunch of gussied up Confederate apologia, if you ask me. Gussied up racism, too. The people who try to excuse the past by saying that's just how things were back then are hoping that future generations will say the same thing about their own unexamined evils. But anyway, the second group of fans, in which I include myself, see the film as a carefully stylized, side-eyed critique of the Confederacy as told from the Confederate perspective.
Well, I don't care what you expect or what they think, I'm gonna dance and dance. Tonight I wouldn't mind dancing with Abe Lincoln himself.
Now, I think most everyone who investigates this controversy in good faith will agree that the mere depiction of racism is not what progressive viewers might take issue with. It's the excusing, or even condoning, of racist ideologies that concerns us. As far as I'm concerned, being great doesn't exonerate the film, because stories don't exist in a vacuum. We need to ask ourselves whether or not Gone with the Wind actually perpetuates Confederate lost cause ideology.
Now, regardless of your political beliefs, whether or not you think the Confederate flag should still fly over the state...
Wait! Stop. This isn't the Confederate flag. This is the Confederate battle flag of the Army of Northern Virginia.
This is the actual Confederate flag, or at least it was, until it was replaced by the so-called stainless banner in 1863, then the bloodstained banner in 1865. Anyway, point is, whether or not you think that some vexillic representation of the Confederacy should still fly proudly over the porches, pickups, and pelvises of the American South, we should all still be able to come to an agreement on this one question. Does Gone with the Wind glorify what it depicts?
It's a tricky question, because glorification is often in the eye of the beholder, but I still think we can draw some defensible conclusions by focusing on 4 specific aspects of the discourse.
What the film makes explicit, what the film implies through coding, what we know of the author's intentions, and what impressions the audience might take away from any given viewing. So let's dive in. The first thing I want to look at is the history of the Confederacy as presented in the film. We already know what the history was, that's what the last video was for, but what does the film have to say about it? Let's take a look at this scene from early in the film. Scarlett is sneaking around 12 Oaks, trying to find Ashley Wilkes so that she can confess her love to him before he has a chance to announce his engagement to Melanie Hamilton. Her search takes her to within earshot of the smoking room, where all the men are busy talking about the impending Civil War.
It's time we made them understand we'll keep our slaves with or without their approval. Was the sovereign right of the state of Georgia to secede from the Union?
That's right.
So this is Scarlett's father talking here, and it's the very first thing we hear in the scene. This would seem to imply that slavery was the main impetus for secession, not something most Confederate apologists would open with. Ashley Wilkes then expresses his hope that the Union will let the South secede in peace.
If Georgia fights, I go with her. But like my father, I hope that the Yankees will let us leave the Union in peace.
As I said in the previous video, this is certainly something that plenty of Southerners were hoping for, to secede in peace. But rather than all the characters simply agreeing with Ashley, we've got some hothead responding like this.
But Ashley!
But Ashley, they've insulted us!
You can't mean you don't want war!
As if the war was a foregone conclusion simply because of the North's negative opinion of secession. Now this particular view, that the South was going to declare war simply because they felt slighted, is not something I've ever read in any historical record. But the fact that the film is presenting the Confederates as these impulsive aggressors is worthy of note. After that exchange, another young buck takes it as a personal offense that Rhett would even imply that the South wasn't assured victory over the North.
Are you hinting, Mr. Butler, that the Yankees can lick us?
No, I'm not hinting. I'm saying very plainly that the Yankees are better equipped than we. They've got factories, shipyards, coal mines, and a fleet to bottle up our harbors and starve us to death. All we've got is cotton and slaves and arrogance.
So what do we have here? We have a scene that suggests the root cause of secession was indeed slavery, and that the South was made up of a bunch of short-sighted war hawks itching to start a war that they were too arrogant to realize they were never going to win, which refutes several major bullet points of Confederate lost cause mythology. But what about slavery? Doesn't Gone with the Wind depict slavery as like this perfectly amenable, happy-go-lucky institution that really wasn't that bad for the country, or even for black people?
Quitting time!
Who says it's quitting time?
I said it's quitting time.
I's the foreman. I's the one says when it's quitting time of terror. Quitting time!
Yeah. Pretty much.
All throughout the film, we never see slaves enduring conditions any worse than that of butlers, farmers, maids, or extremely incompetent midwives. Nobody gets whipped, nobody gets bought or sold, families aren't broken up, nobody's brutalized or murdered, and of course there's only one single attempt at interrogating the morality of slavery itself, and it ends with Ashley Wilkes suggesting it's okay to keep slaves so long as you don't treat them poorly.
Scarlett, I will not make money out of the enforced labor and misery of others.
You weren't so particular about owning slaves.
Well, that was different. We didn't treat them that way.
No doubt plenty of slave owners. Hell, I've heard members of my own family say that sure, slavery was bad, yeah. But a lot of slavers treated their slaves like family, taught them to read and write, to become ministers. Anything but freedom, right?
Yeah, I've never been super clear on what sort of point the Confederate apologists are trying to make here when they argue that slavery abuses may have indeed presented on a spectrum. Like, seriously, what's your point? I encourage you all to explain yourselves in the comments. Because it sounds to me like you're saying slavery isn't worth condemning so long as it was done out of some paternalistic sense of evangelism for profit.
So let's cut to the chase. If I thought Gone with the Wind were actually endorsing this position, I wouldn't be able to watch it. Without question, it'd be slavery apology of the most unambiguous kind. But I honestly don't think the film is trying to endorse this position, and what's more, I think the filmmakers might actually want us to know that.
The key factor is in who they gave the line to. If Melanie Hamilton or Rhett Butler had said it, I'd consider it a tacit authorial endorsement, since Melanie and Rhett are really the closest things we get to any sort of moral arbiter in the film. Rhett may not always do good. In fact, he might rarely do good.
Smash your skull between them like a walnut.
But he's one of the only characters whose moral compass always points north. He may not always abide by it, but at least he knows the heading. But Ashley, despite that hypnotic transatlantic by way of Georgia accent and those curly blonde locks that never seem to fall out of place, Ashley Wilkes is not presented in the film as the great arbiter of truth and morality. On the contrary, he's an obsequious, self-delusional, and chronically hypocritical fuckboy.
If you knew what I've gone through.
Even when the film gives him the benefit of soft, glowing lighting and a swelling musical score, it's usually only during his more ludicrous moments. Like when he points out that Melanie Hamilton being his first cousin is actually a selling point for marriage.
She's like me, Scarlett. She's part of my blood and we understand each other.
He does occasionally dole out sage advice on the horrors of war.
Most of the miseries of the world were caused by wars. And when the wars were over, no one ever knew what they were about.
But even these moments aren't in service of advancing Confederate apologetics. On the contrary, this quote would seem to suggest the pointlessness of the entire cause.
Now, I know some people disagree with this interpretation. They think that Ashley's supposed to be this tragic, upstanding gentleman of the South. But I always saw Ashley as the living embodiment of self-delusional Southern gentleman hypocrisy. And I don't think that's just me reading into the text. I think he's specifically coded that way.
Dreams, always dreams with you. Never common sense.
Oh, Scarlett, if you knew what I've gone through.
But perhaps we should talk more about what coding is, because that's not the only coding that I see in the film.
Coding is when a text makes certain editorial statements about its own content without necessarily making those statements explicitly. Like when all the men in the smoking room are saying they can't wait to go to war while the most sympathetic character in the scene, and the only character with even an ounce of self-awareness, is in the corner chuckling to himself about the foolishness of it all. See, for every pro-Confederate statement made by someone in this film, there's like a call and response, a suspicious side-eyeing that actively questions the merits of the Confederacy.
Now get back to work. I can't do everything at Terra all by myself.
What do I care about Terra? I hate Terra.
These editorializations tend to ease up after the first several reels, but only because we're supposed to have gotten the point by then. Rhett Butler is a big part of that. He's easily the most self-aware character in the film, and that self-consciousness is put to good use by him giving a running commentary on the political and moral ramifications of nearly every scene he's in.
And you, Mrs. Hamilton, I know just how much that means to you.
Sometimes it's downright meta.
You should have made your presence known.
In the middle of that beautiful love scene?
And Rhett, notably, doesn't have a high opinion of the Confederacy.
Are you trying to tell me you don't believe in the cause?
I believe in Rhett Butler. He's the only cause I know.
He does eventually join the fight, but only at the end of the war, and only after he's certain they're going to lose.
Maybe it's because I've always had a weakness for lost causes once they're really lost.
And even then, he can't help but note the foolishness of his own behavior.
I'll never understand or forgive myself. And if a bullet gets me, so help me, I'll laugh at myself for being an idiot.
None of this makes Rhett a good man, mind you.
I'll smash your skull between them like a walnut.
But he'd be the first person to agree with that.
I am neither noble nor heroic.
That doesn't make him any less morally compromised, but it makes him invaluable for the purposes of editorial coding. See, a lot of people dismiss Gone with the Wind because it looks just like so much Confederate propaganda to them.
Just look at those sweeping vistas, that rousing score. Read the opening text crawl, for God's sake.
But that's the point.
See, this flowery pro-slavery prose doesn't sound like something Rhett would say, or even Ashley or Scarlett. This sounds like all those hotheads that the film would be making fun of in 20 minutes.
In its opening act, Gone with the Wind deliberately replicates the look and feel of Confederate propaganda, because it is, after all, a story told from the perspective of the South, but only in such an exaggerated fashion that the audience is clued into the fact that the perspectives they're about to see are irrevocably biased, and then it spends the next several reels letting Rhett Butler tear those perspectives to pieces. I know this might sound like I'm reading too much into this, interpreting the tea leaves as I see fit, but I don't think I am. This is all recognizable film language here, and what's more, I've seen the exact same techniques used in other films that are unequivocally opposed to the ideologies of their main characters. And if you're having trouble picturing what that might look like, allow me to direct your attention to a film that I bet you never thought would pop up in a video about Gone with the Wind.
Young people from all over the globe are joining up to fight for the future.
I'm doing my part.
I'm doing my part.
I'm doing my part.
I'm doing my part too.
Now, I'll be the first to admit that Starship Troopers is a very pointed satire, in a way that Gone with the Wind clearly isn't. But if you start with the desire to tell a story from the perspective of slavers and fascists,
I'm from Buenos Aires, and I say kill them all!
And you don't want to show any support for their ideologies, but you also don't want to turn your film into a sermonizing after-school special, you might construct a film very similar to either of these two, in which almost every character is a short-sighted, self-interested jingoist with nary an ounce of self-awareness.
And force, my friends, is violence, the supreme authority from which all other authority is derived.
And that any sentiment expressed by the characters in support of totalitarianism, or armed rebellion in the name of slavery, is done with this sort of winking irony.
Don't talk about Carmen that way!
Johnny,
how dare you? You aren't fit to wipe his boot!
And you were going to hate him for the rest of your life!
Even their trumpeting fanfares are similarly aggrandizing.
But wait, just hang on a minute. Couldn't someone still make the argument that Gone with the Wind is a pro-Confederate film, but only with just enough muted side-eyeing to give touchy-feely leftists enough plausible deniability to claim otherwise?
I mean, at the end of the day, can you really get any more reverential than this?
Oh, you sweet summer child, may I present, for your viewing displeasure,
Gods and Generals.
And I hope by your future deeds and there, and you will be handed down to posterity.
as the 1st Brigade. And that's our second war of independence.
For those who don't know, Gods and Generals is a 3.5-hour Civil War battle reenactment intercut with footage of Generals Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson pontificating about all the numerous glories of the Confederacy.
There's something these Yankees do not understand, will never understand.
You'd think it was made in 1903, not 2003.
Just as we would not send any of our soldiers to march in other states and tyrannize other people, so will we never allow the armies of others to march into our state and tyrannize our people.
I literally don't have enough time to play all the clips that attempt to exonerate the Confederacy here.
Well, they know we're fighting for our independence.
It makes Gone with the Wind look like young Mr. Lincoln.
I never thought I'd live to see the day that a president of the United States would raise an army to invade his own country.
Now, Gone with the Wind is similarly chock full of characters who stand the Confederacy and want to cancel the Union, but there's one crucial difference. The characters in Gone with the Wind are presented as protagonists, whereas the characters in Gods and Generals are presented as heroes. Where Scarlett O'Hara is a conniving cutthroat bent on personal gain, whose ruthless methods of self-preservation raise eyebrows all throughout the film, Stonewall Jackson is presented as a transcendently pious man with nary a single human flaw. Amen. Hey, you want to know how Stonewall Jackson died? He got shot by his own troops while taking an unannounced night ride through no man's land. In hindsight, seems almost fitting.
God has fixed the time for my death. I do not concern myself with that.
Every time some kid has to decide whether he's gonna fight for the North or the South, he screws his courage to the sticking place and chooses his beloved home state as the music swells in the most painfully unironic way.
Colonel Jackson, sir. Father. I am a soldier in the 4th Virginia.
That's one of the ways you can tell how one side of the film's politics are. There's never any counter-argument for anything that the Confederates say or do. Just these dumb reaction shots every time Robert E. Lee says something sagacious and in the middle distance.
He's lost his left arm. I've lost my right.
Wait, I take that back. There is one scene where Union officer Joshua Chamberlain gives a sermonizing speech about the evils of slavery.
I will admit it, Tom, war is a scourge, but so is slavery.
But it feels so bolted on and out of place within the context of the rest of the film that it actually made me wonder if it was perhaps included as a way to try and mock the Union. As if the filmmakers were saying, look at these moralizing Yankees, worried about the slaves, when we all know the South was set to free them all anyway. As far as this film is concerned, nobody was in favor of slavery during the Civil War. There's even a scene where Stonewall Jackson, who owns slaves, mind you, practically prays for the swift end of slavery and then tells his free black cook that the higher-ups within the Confederacy are hoping to grant freedom to any slave who fights for the Southern cause.
Your people will be free, one way or the other. The only question is whether the Southern government will have the good sense to do it first and soon.
Just one problem. That never actually happened, not even close. It was only ever floated as a trial balloon in the last few desperate months of the war. To say nothing of the fact that offering freedom from bondage as a reward for enlistment, as a reward for anything for that matter, is still morally reprehensible. Like, we all know if Aladdin were really such a great guy, he would have freed Genie with his first wish, not his last.
Now, is that an official wish? Say the magic words. Genie, I wish for your freedom.
All right! Yo, yo, woo, woo.
But I'm still not willing to leave it at that. Why doesn't this film just condemn slavery outright? Why doesn't it show slavery for the evil that it is? Well, this is where authorial intent finally comes into play. Producer David O. Selznick is probably the closest we'll ever get to an actual author of this film. Gone with the Wind had 3 different directors working on it, 3 cinematographers, and no less than 6 different writers, but each and every one of them reported to Selznick. He was the one who shepherded the project from the initial acquisition of the rights to the final premiere. By all accounts, Selznick was a progressive liberal who wanted to make a film that was sympathetic to African Americans, writing in one studio memo, see, Selznick was worried about a repeat of 1915, when the release of Birth of a Nation almost single-handedly revived interest in the Ku Klux Klan, which had laid largely dormant for the previous 4 decades. Selznick is responsible for excising any mention of the Klan from the script. In this scene, where a Union officer shows up trying to find Rhett Butler and a bunch of men who may have been involved in a recent killing, Melanie says they're at a political meeting.
Search if you like, but Mr. Wilkes is at a political meeting at Mr. Kennedy's store.
He's not at the store, and there's no meeting tonight.
No political meeting.
In the original novel, their cover was a KKK rally. In studio memos, Selznick says he made the edit not to try and sanitize the history of the South, but because he felt it would be too much of a narrative burden for the film to make the characters Klan members and then have to explain to the audience that the filmmakers weren't actually endorsing the Klan. And if you're wondering why he didn't have the same concerns about presenting the characters as slavers, I suspect it's because slavery was both illegal and universally condemned by society at large in 1939, whereas the Klan was decidedly not. For the most part, Selznick seems to have been more concerned with humanizing the black characters of Gone with the Wind than he was with condemning slavery. The novel contains some rather notorious passages that describe Mammy as a whereas Haiti McDaniel's characterization is decidedly warm, witty, and empathic. Mammy is, in fact, the only main character besides Rhett who explicitly condemns much of Scarlett's behavior.
You know what trouble I was talking about? I was talking about Mr. Ashton Wilkes. He'll be coming to Atlanta when he gets his leave, and you sitting there waiting for him just like a spider.
But not everyone agreed that Selznick succeeded in making the black character sympathetic. Critics immediately pointed out that Mammy and the rest of Scarlett's slaves never seemed to resent being held in bondage. Critic and dramatist Carlton Moss even invoked Birth of a Nation in his review of the film, saying that while Birth of a Nation was a frontal attack on American history, Gone with the Wind was a rear attack on the same. He called the film a nostalgic plea for sympathy for a still-living cause of Southern reaction. Picketers at the premiere marched with signs that read, "You'd be sweet too under a whip," to say nothing of the fact that Selznick also caved to racist regional pressures, allowing the premiere to proceed at the Lowe's Grand Theater in Atlanta even though it refused to seat black people, because he didn't want to offend the very delicate Southern attitude towards segregation. It seems that for every step forward that Selznick took, there was a corresponding step sideways. Selznick led the push to get Haiti McDaniel an Oscar, but even as wonderful as that recognition was, it didn't prevent McDaniel from being typecast as the maid for the rest of her career. I couldn't even name another film from Haiti McDaniel's filmography until I looked it up, and Butterfly McQueen was basically forced to retire after she refused to play any more roles that she found demeaning to black people.
I didn't want to be in any and everything. I wanted to be in quality things.
My take on Selznick is that he seems to have meant well, and he certainly moved the needle, but he also acted as if it was his job to decide what was best for oppressed minority groups, rather than letting oppressed minority groups decide what was best for themselves. And lots of people were rightfully hoping for more than just incremental progress with a project as high profile as this. Curiously enough, there's still one major aspect of the film that we haven't really talked about yet. I think probably because she's really one of the least ambiguous aspects of the film. I'm referring, of course, to the main character, Scarlett O'Hara. Scarlett epitomizes the difference between a hero and a protagonist. You won't hear me trying to argue that Scarlett O'Hara is a good person. Not even Scarlett would argue that.
I'm afraid of dying. I'm going to hell.
She certainly has virtues, like strength and willfulness, but she's not virtuous. On the contrary, she's a brutal and manipulative self-preservationist who doesn't think twice about screwing over anyone who gets in her way.
Well, she's going to marry one of the county boys next month. She just got tired of waiting, was afraid she'd be an old maid, and oh, I'm sorry to be the one to tell you.
Who copes with the difficulties of life by literally shooting first and asking questions later.
I guess I've done murder. I won't think about that now. I'll think about that tomorrow.
And that's the point.
Melanie, my dear, my darling wife.
Scarlett isn't a hero, she's an anti-hero. Nothing she does is meant to be an endorsement of said behavior. I think that's one thing the film is exceedingly clear on.
I left my muff at home. Would you mind if I put my hand in your pocket?
But of course, a character doesn't need to be good or moral in order for us to get catharsis out of their story. We're not supposed to evaluate Scarlett's actions from Scarlett's perspective. Rhett and Mammy are the ones who offer all the editorial analysis we'll ever need. They both want Scarlett to succeed, but not by any of the methods she actually uses to get ahead. Rhett admires the virtues he sees in Scarlett, but he's almost literally driven mad waiting around for her to become a better person. And that's not on Scarlett, that's on Rhett, for wanting Scarlett to be the way that he wants her to be rather than the way she ever actually was. This too is made explicit by none other than Rhett himself, who surmises that the whole reason he wanted a daughter with Scarlett so badly was because he wanted a version of her who would accept the kind of love that he was offering.
She was so like you, and I could pet her and spoil her as I wanted to spoil you.
And in the end, when Rhett realizes they've both missed too many opportunities for self-improvement,
frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
He leaves. But before that final moment, we witness what is perhaps the most incendiary scene in the entire film, which actually has nothing to do with the Confederacy.
And I'll smash your skull between them like a walnut.
So first, a little context. This is late in the film, after Scarlett and Rhett have been married for several years, with Rhett still holding out hope that Scarlett might finally drop her torch for Ashley and fall in love with him. But Scarlett rebuffs him, and as a token of her resolve, she says she's not going to share a bed with him ever again.
No, but you know what I... Do you know what I mean?
I do.
Rhett plays it cool over the denial of sex, but he can't take the romantic rebuff.
You mean to say you don't care?
The world is full of many things and many people, and I shan't be lonely. I'll find comfort elsewhere.
Well, that's fine. But I warn you, just in case you change your mind, I intend to lock my door.
Why bother? If I wanted to come in, no lock could keep me up.
Later that night, Rhett gets drunk, revoices all of his displeasures, threatens to kill Scarlett with his bare hands, and then hauls her up the stairs to rape.
This is one night you're not turning me on.
An image that the marketing campaign then co-opted to try and push the film as a swooning romance. The next morning, the film heavily implies that Scarlett enjoyed the experience. But here's the thing. Whether she did or didn't doesn't determine whether or not it was rape. Let me say that again. Whether or not Scarlett enjoyed it has no bearing on whether or not Rhett committed rape. Rhett had sex with her without her consent, after she told him she wasn't going to sleep with him, no less.
Well, I hope I don't have any more children.
Rhett committed marital rape in no uncertain terms. Now, I for one absolutely despise the all-too-common trope where a man has sex with a woman without her consent, only to have his actions hand-waved away by the filmmakers by suggesting the woman enjoyed it.
Are all nerds as good as you?
As far as I'm concerned, this is the epitome, the quintessence of rape culture. It teaches men that the thing to seek isn't consent, but rather post-hoc absolution, which can apparently take the form of just showing her a good time. But where Gone with the Wind breaks from the trope is in what happens next.
Hello. I'd like to extend my apology for my conduct of last night.
Oh, but Red.
I was very drunk and quite swept off my feet by your charms.
He offers Scarlett a tacit apology. Then he offers Scarlett a divorce.
I've been thinking things over, and I really believe it would be better for both of us if we admitted we'd made a mistake and got a divorce.
Which she rejects on the pretense that it would be too socially humiliating.
Thank you very much, but I wouldn't dream of disgracing the family with a divorce.
Rhett then announces he's leaving for Europe.
I'm going on a very extended trip to London.
See, my take on this scene is that there was no way he was going to stick around. Not after what he'd done. The apology doesn't absolve Rhett, mind you. I don't think anything does. But what's worthy of note here is that the film is not rewarding him for his actions. See, a lot of people interpret the scene as a tacit condoning of marital rape. Or worse, they don't think it depicts a rape at all. But I, for one, think this film is both depicting a rape in no uncertain terms and quietly condemning it, which is only as loud as they could condemn it, given the restrictions that the Hays Code put on the production. We never see Rhett even momentarily gratified for his attack, nor does it solidify, strengthen, or repair their marriage. On the contrary, it's the final act that leads to its ultimate destruction.
Excuse me, Mr. Rhett.
It's important, I think, to understand and even empathize with Scarlett's motivations. She was born into a world that has nothing of her, built on the backs of the oppressed, who got everything taken away without anyone telling her she had anything to offer except the ability to marry up. But empathy and sympathy aren't the same thing. We can empathize with Scarlett without wanting to see her succeed. Not like this, anyway. Simply put, Scarlett isn't a heroine, she's a mess. And I am a card-carrying, messy bitch who lives for drama. Her fate is a tragedy, not a romance. The fact that it's a tragedy of her own making doesn't make it any less tragic. She's punished for her hubris, and what's more, she doesn't even know she's lost by the end of the film.
But I'll think of some way to get him back. After all, tomorrow is another day.
Kind of like the true legacy of the Confederacy, if you ask me. If Gone with the Wind has a great sin, it's that by not explicitly condemning the Confederacy, it gives plausible deniability to the bigots who would watch it and go, yes, that's my old beloved South.
And it's because of this omission, which people were pointing out as soon as it premiered, that viewers like me feel compelled to dedicate enormous amounts of time and energy repudiating the viewers who would seek to use this film as a showpiece for their racist ideologies. I spent about 4 months in active production on this video series, which means I spent a third of a year, almost 1% of my entire life, analyzing, interpreting, and expounding my views on the film just so that I could put it on my shelf. That's the problem with this film. You don't know what you're condoning by simply turning it on in public. It is the film's fault that we are still asking this question even 80 years later. But I don't think that's a problem best solved by banning Gone with the Wind. I mean, as a blanket rule. I've got no problem with theaters canceling local screenings if they can't account for the political leanings of their audiences, especially when the theater happens to be located in the state that birthed the KKK. But as one of my friends put it, Gone with the Wind should definitely still be watched, but it needs to be more than just watched. It needs to be discussed, interpreted, contextualized, which is what I hope I've done with these videos. But we can't stop here. We need to finally start making better media about the Civil War. Yes, better than Gone with the Wind. Like, you know what's way cooler than a TV show headlined by two white guys about what the United States would look like if the South had won the Civil War? How about a TV show about what the United States would look like if slaves had actually gotten reparations? If Andrew Johnson hadn't rescinded the 40 acres and a mule promise? If Confederate veterans hadn't gotten their voting rights restored by a sympathetic Southern president within 3 years of the end of the war? If Jim Crow hadn't happened? If Plessy v. Ferguson went the other way? If the Civil Rights Act were passed in 1864 instead of 1964? If the Southern strategy hadn't been a thing? Maybe if the ruling classes of the United States hadn't deliberately codified racial hierarchies into the fabric of American life in the wake of Bacon's Rebellion as a way to keep the lower classes in check way back in 1676, I'd watch the shit out of that. And I'm just a white boy from Davie. What's your excuse?